Hello there, I'm Lee from Educative. Welcome to Educative Sessions. If you like this episode, please be sure to click the like button below wherever it may be. Also, don't forget to subscribe and get reminders on future content. Enjoy. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Educative Sessions, a podcast series with people in the developer world about their coding experiences. This is brought to you by Educative, which makes it easy for authors to provide interactive and adaptive courses for software developers. My name is Lee Ngo, and I am the host of Educative Sessions. And today, my guest is Adodoola Omiyale. And today, we're going to talk about how curiosity didn't kill this cat. Adodoola is also a contributor to Educative Answers and also a software developer and just really an amazing person. Adodoola, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you, Lee. Thank you for having me. I'm a bit nervous, but,
you're going to do great.
We move.
No worries.
Yeah. I'm a software developer. That's a great title, but officially I'm not. Maybe I'm like aspiring to be.
In a lot of ways, I've come to realize that people are very touchy about titles. Okay. And the people that had the titles just kind of gave themselves the titles and worked into them. That's most of the case. And so that's a little bit of advice for you too. But why don't we talk a little bit about what you've been doing prior to getting into software, right? Where are you from originally and how did you get to the place you're at now?
Yeah, so I was raised in the UK, London, and I'm originally from Nigeria. I've started recently going back and forth to Nigeria as well. I was studying social sciences at uni. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying I didn't enjoy it, but I knew it was something that I didn't want to focus on when I left. Mm-hmm. And the thing about uni sometimes is that it puts you in this box of when you leave uni, you have to do that, you have to do this. So I kind of deviated away from that plan and I wanted a job that I could push myself and challenge myself, and sales is that job. You do things out of your comfort zone, you improve so many soft skills. So I was like, let me just jump into sales. And then I actually work currently for a test automation company. So that's how I kind of like was introduced into like the software developer coding like world realm. And I wanted to know more about it because I was really interested in it. So I just jumped right in and it's been an up and down journey ever since. So that tiny piece of curiosity made me want to stick at it and just continue developing my skills in that sort of sector, even though it's a big sector, just like continue to understand what these developers are saying. And so that's how I got introduced to it.
Absolutely, that's cool. And I like that for a lot of people, if they have that bit of curiosity, more often than not, they won't entertain it. They'll just be like, oh, that's cute and nice, but they'll just let it fall out of their heads and move on with their day. But instead, you leaned a lot more into it and you spent a lot more time with software developers. How was that like? Well, what was it like going from hanging out with people who were on sales teams to hanging out with people who are more inclined with technology?
So I always, even though sales is like, you have to know your product inside and out, that's only just like the surface of the product, right? Like the front, you can say like the front end of the product. You don't really, well, for me personally, I didn't really get into the sort of like nitty gritties of the technology behind the product. And what I found with talking to that developers and software is that like, it's super collaborative. They know like the product from like the minuscule level. They'll know the product from the most detailed right. level. And I had this misconception that developers are these people that are in like dark rooms by themselves, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. they just focusing on just coding all day and everything, but it's actually not like that. It's like very collaborative, it's very open, they actually want your input, even if you're not from a software development background. They want different types of inputs from different sort of departments to help like build this product that can be the best for their target market. So that's what I really liked about it like being in those stand-ups and hearing them communicate, asking for my advice when I didn't know anything. I still don't know hardly anything. It's just different in that sense. Mm-hmm. They know the product on the most detailed level, and they're willing to get your input even if you're not from a technical background, which I really appreciated.
That's wonderful. I relate to that a lot. I've had experiences where a lot of people on the technology teams or the coding teams would actually want me to stay away from product, right? They are very guarded about it. They don't want me to mess around with it. And yet the fact that the product teams in your case have actually had conversations with you and want your insight, regardless of your skill set, I think that's the kind of community I would want to work for, and the kind of things that would be great to foster is that open sharing. Yeah. So, you know, you eventually started making code, right?
I did a couple like Hello Worlds on the console,
Everybody starts with Hello World. That is the rite of passage, right? Yeah. And that is, to me, it seems cheap, but it is truly the moment where you step behind the threshold and become a coder.
Yes.
No one can take that away from you. And I think if anyone tries, you know, they're just not great people, in my opinion. So what was the experience like? Like, did you enjoy the, you know, building a Hello World is pretty exciting, but was there something more to the experience that like you wanted to share?
Yeah, so I'll tell you how I actually got into it. I think I was just searching on LinkedIn and I saw that someone within my network completed a JavaScript course. And I was like, should I see what it's about? Should I not? So I eventually visited the website and I did a little like introductory sort of lesson, which was like a couple of hours. And I actually like loved it. Like, I loved the fact that you can just write some lines of different letters and words and numbers, and it can produce something that's really powerful. Bearing in mind, I say that to say that when I first started it, I was a mess. Honestly, like, I didn't know what anything meant. Even though I was on the course, I was still googling. I was still googling what does this do, what does that do.
But that's what coders do.
It's so true. Like, whenever I see some like documentation that's like work, like explained to perfection, I'm just like, yes, that's what I needed. But I saw the power that it has and the potential that I can grow. Stay doing this. So I just stuck at it. It's like requires a lot of discipline, a lot of hard work, because especially if you're doing this as a site on the side, there's sometimes when you just like want to give up, but I've got like an end goal in mind that I want to achieve. So that's what's like at the back of my head, or the back of my mind, when I'm figuring out like something that's really complicated. That's how I really started, and that's why I'm continuing.
I think it sounds like everything that you're going through, it's explained as if this is what coding shouldn't be, but it's totally everybody's experience is. Yeah. In fact, when I used to run my own company, and my CTO, he would interview hoping that that person says, if you needed to find out something, what do you do? The bad answer is ask him, because he doesn't want to be bothered. I didn't love as an answer, but the real answer he said was to find out on your own, to experiment. Yeah. Right. I actually like that answer a lot, because a lot of code isn't written for, like, you're not following directions and just doing copy and paste. At some point you have to get improvisational, right? You have to get creative.
Exactly. That's something that I like about it as well. You can be so creative, and there's so many different languages that you can learn. Yeah. And they do different things, and you can produce different things. You can grab insight from different things. So everything is not so, it's not like copy and paste. Mm-hmm. It's all very different, and you can produce different outcomes from it. So that's what I really like. You have that flexibility to move around if you wanted to, so.
Brilliant. That's so cool. And so, you know, now that your curiosity has been realized, what do you hope to do with this discovery about yourself? Where do you see yourself in the future?
Just crazy. So that's a question that I've always struggled with, because again, I'm still starting this journey, but I would really love to do something within like data visualization. Yeah, that's like something that I'm really like interested in, and also do more of like technical writing and hopefully get some like a bit of like money from it. That would be great as well. Do I want something full-time? I don't think I do, because I always find that sometimes when your passion's like your 9 to 5, you kind of lose a bit of that interest, and you kind of lose like the hunger that you felt when it was just something that you were passionate about and interested in. Mm-hmm. But I want to be able to inform and inspire people with different like data visualization like projects and stuff. So that's where my focus is on, really. And technical writing, I love doing that because it makes me learn what I'm writing as well.
Yeah, I love all that. And you know what's amazing is that you have so many options, right? You can go into technical writing, and that still requires a little bit of the skill set that you clearly have, which is as a communicator and someone that can work with people, and a little bit of technological knowledge as well. Also, data visualization. To me, I feel like there's a thread going on. I know a lot of people who jumped into data visualization because they want the technological background, but they want to express things with a little bit of beauty, a little bit of design. And a lot of that is all there. I think the sky's the limit for you, honestly. And I think there are so many different kinds of coders, and the ones that I've met who are, they have the technological background, but they eventually cater it towards their passion. Maybe not to an extreme where it becomes, their whole entire life, but just enough so that they're enjoying their work a little bit more, right? At least.
Yeah. Exactly that. Like, I just feel like with how life is going right now and how the world is and everything, if you have a piece of something that you can be like, yes, I really enjoy, and it's something that can ease your mind and expand your mind and everything like that and make you think in a healthy way, I think let it just stay where it is. Let it just stay there. There's no need to overthink about how I can make this as such a great thing. If it's something that that gives you that natural hunger, then I just feel like it's something that should just stay by itself. It doesn't need to be touched or modified or anything, if I'm making sense.
I think so. I think, there's no real, it's the only playbook really around all of this is according to what makes sense for you. It's one of those things. We're a big fan at Educative. We talk a lot about the unknown unknowns, right?
Yeah.
And how sometimes you just have to go venture without too much of a plan, because you might discover something that was unplanned that ends up being the right thing you all along. And I think that's what you did. That's what, the big thing about curiosity is that it requires courage in order to explore it. And it requires a sense of discovery that most people are too afraid of. And I think there's still maybe a few steps on your journey as you figure this all out, but I'm very excited for you. I think this is a lovely thing for you. And, a big part of this discovery, I presume, is how you found us too, and how you became a contributor with us. And if it wasn't for that, we wouldn't be here. So.
Exactly.
So Adodoola, we are at the end of our podcast, and I wanted to give you an opportunity to do a shameless plug of sorts, or something that's, passionate for you, relevant to your community. The floor is yours. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I have been looking at some of your other guests that you've had, and you've got a big Nigerian community. Educative has a big Nigerian community. Like, it's just insane. It's crazy.
We're very proud of that, actually.
Yeah. Like, I love it. I love it so much. Like, it's amazing. It's incredible. Mm-hmm. I'm actually going to be in Nigeria in December. I would love to meet up with anybody that's on part of any Educative ambassadors, any Educative technical writers, just to have a conversation, just to see where everybody's at, what their aspirations are, what they want to do, how they're going to use this skill maybe to uplift and empower their community, or even the country, like Nigeria as a whole. So just a little shout out that I would definitely love to talk to you. I'll probably reach out to them, but this is just a shout out that I'm going to be in Nigeria, so it'll be good to have a face-to-face meetup.
Yeah. You know what? As a personal favor to all you've done, I am going to make sure that this episode gets in front of those eyeballs and try to connect with as many. I mean, it'd be weird. I don't think I have a designated Nigerian playlist of sorts when it comes to educative sessions, but I think they will automatically find this and respond to you. And yes, they are a fantastic community and one that, and they all know each other and they all support each other often through Educative, which has been really, really wonderful to see. I mean, I've never met a single one in person. I would say every single one of their stories have inspired me when it comes to my work as well.
That's great. Well, that's great. That's amazing.
Adodoola, thank you so much for being on this show and being really just you and sharing so much of your own story. I want to thank you, and I want to thank anyone else who's watching this on YouTube or checking us out on any major podcasting app. You can learn a lot more about us on educative.io. You can learn about Adodoola's work and other people's work at educative.io/answers. And that's pretty much everything. So for all of us here at Educative, thank you so much and happy learning. Bye-bye now.
Bye, guys. Bye.
Bye. Hello there, Lee here from Educative. Hope you enjoyed this latest episode with Educative Sessions. If you like this episode, please click on the like button somewhere. You can find more episodes on YouTube or on any major podcasting app. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. It actually helps us a lot. Happy learning.